Hello students, today we are discussing about the behavior therapy. You are aware that there are number of therapies which are helpful in treating the mental disorders. For instance, psychoanalytic therapy, humanistic therapy, gestalt therapy, rational emotive therapy and behavior therapy, to name a few. So in today's class, let us discuss about what is this behavior therapy, what is the historical background, what are the assumptions based upon which the behavior therapy has arose, what are the goals, what is the function of the behaviorist therapist role, and what are the experiences of the client during the behavior therapy process. So let us start understanding the historical background for the emergence of the behavior therapy. The behavioral approach has started emerging in 1950s and 1960s as a radical departure from the existing psychotherapies. The behavior therapy movement differed from other therapeutic approaches because of its application of the principles of classical conditioning and operant conditioning in the treatment of variety of problem behaviors. Contemporary behavior therapy arose simultaneously in United States of America, South Africa and Great Britain in 1950s. In spite of harsh criticism and also the resistance from the traditional psychotherapists, the approach was able to survive. That is, the behavior therapy gained momentum in dealing with the client's problems. The focus was on demonstrating how the behavioral principles of learning, especially the classical conditioning and operant conditioning, were a viable alternative to traditional psychotherapy. In 1960, Albert Bandura developed social learning theory combining classical conditioning and operant conditioning along with the observational learning. At the same time, there are number of cognitive behavioral approaches which sprang up, which are trying to provide alternative strategies in dealing with the client's problems. For example, Albert Ellis developed his own therapy, rational emotive behavior therapy. Aaron Beck developed his own cognitive therapy, and Donald Meckenbaum developed certain skills like stress inoculation and self-instructional training. It was during 1970s, however, that behavior therapy emerged as a major force in psychology and tried to have a significant impact on education, psychotherapy, psychiatry, and social work. Behavioral techniques were developed, expanded, and they were also applied to various fields and variety of fields like business, industry, and also in the child rearing practices. Once we have understood how this behavior therapy has emerged, every therapy has its own philosophical approach in understanding human behavior. Based upon this philosophical view of human nature, each therapy developed its own techniques. Now let us see what is the view of human nature according to the behavior therapists. Modern behavior therapy did not allow the deterministic or mechanistic view of human nature. They did not believe that a person is a mere product of conditioning processes. But the current view of behavior therapists is the person is both a producer and also a product of his or her own environment. However, radical behaviorists like Skinner, based upon the stimulus response model behaviors, felt that individual has no freedom or no will in molding himself. However, when Bandura focused on the socio-cognitive approach, he strongly felt individual is not mere mechanically trying to respond to the environment, but he is also actively following his own cognitive processes. Another assumption of behaviorist therapy is, as counseling should be, especially the behavior therapy should be an action-oriented approach, clients should be given a prominent role. Especially, clients do not benefit by only reflecting upon what has already has happened, but at the most, they have to identify what has happened and then shift over to what to be done in the future and especially in the present to make the future a more productive life. So behavior therapies are concerned with how stimulus events are mediated by cognitive processes and also subjective meanings. Behavior therapists emphasized on the client's responsibility. Unless we take our own responsibility for our own situations, we cannot mold ourselves or we cannot mold our situations. Another assumption of behavior therapists is people have the capacity to improve their lives provided that they are willing to change one or more factors which are influencing their behavior. What are the main characteristics of behavior therapy? Each therapy has its own significant features when compared to the other therapies. The first characteristic is behavior therapy is based upon the principles and procedures of scientific method. That is, most of the principles of behavior therapy were experimentally proved and they have been useful in applying in the counseling or therapeutic processes. Second characteristic is behavior therapy focuses on the client's current problems and the current factors which are influencing them rather than on the historical determinants. The third characteristic is in behavior therapy, clients are expected to act rather than merely be passive in listening to what the client is saying. Naturally, in the therapeutic process, the clients are not only asked to talk about their condition, but they are asked to monitor their behaviors during and also after the sessions and learn and practice new coping behaviors and also role play new behaviors. Another important characteristic of behavior therapy is behavior therapy is generally carried out in client's natural environment as much as possible. The behavioristic approach is largely educational and emphasis is more on learning. Behavior therapy emphasizes on teaching the clients skills management, or we can say social skills management or self-management skills, which help them to confront the situations and deal effectively with the situations. In this process, they would also be given homework assignments to practice even after the sessions and then implement it in the real life situations. Behavior therapy also emphasizes on self-control of the client. The therapist frequently train the client to initiate, conduct, and evaluate his own therapeutic process or treatment process as part of the therapy. Behavioral procedures are tailor-made so that they are fit to the each individual client's needs. There are a number of techniques which are used depending upon the situation, depending upon the need of the client's problem. For example, when dealing with a client, the therapist always thinks what treatment should be given, to whom it should be given, how effective it would be, what strategy has to be used, and under what conditions we have to use these strategies. So, though there are a bag of behavioral techniques, all the techniques cannot be used with all the clients. The therapist uses his own discretion so that the client would benefit more of a particular technique rather than the others. Another important characteristic of behavior therapy is it is based on a collaborative partnership between the therapist and the client, and every attempt is made to inform the client about the whole proceedings of the therapeutic process. That is, the client cannot deny or the client cannot object that he is not aware of any particular treatment method or the treatment process. In addition, behavior therapies, who is following or which therapist is conducting a therapy, there are certain common features in all the behavior therapies. Behavior therapy moves from simple to complex, easy to harder, and from less threatening to more threatening aspects. Another important characteristic is the behavior therapy is relatively brief, often involving only few therapy sessions, and in that way it is less time consuming and also less expensive compared to the other therapies. There are several behavioral techniques, but they are not used commonly in all the clients. depending upon the need of the client, a particular strategy will be used in order to facilitate that the client has learnt a new coping behavior. Once we have understood what are the basic characteristics, we have to undergo the therapeutic process followed by the behavior therapist. In fact, every therapy, depending upon their name, depending upon their mode, has certain aspects in common. That is, they have to set the goals, therapeutic goals. The therapist has to be very clear about his own role, and the client should be having a precise role in a particular therapy, and what sort of a relationship that has to be followed between the therapist and the client. So now let us start with what are the therapeutic goals in a behavior therapy. The first general goal is to create new conditions for learning on the assumption that learning ameliorates problematic behaviors. Generally, the client formulates the goals in the behavior therapy at the outset of the session with the help of the therapist. After that, continuous assessment is made both by the client and also by the therapist whether the client is reaching the goals or not. We can say assessment and treatment occur together in this behavior therapy. Another goal is the behavior therapy stresses client's active role compared to their counterparts in the other therapies. That is, the therapist assists the clients to set the goals in a clear, unambiguous, and more measurable form. Behavior therapy also ensures that the rights of the client are protected. This is one important goal in the behavior therapy. And this is reflected in the way the goals are in detail specified, target behaviors identified, and complete reliance on only empirically tested procedures, the brief nature of treatment, and the collaborative relationship between the therapy and the client. All these indicate that the client's needs are taken care of. Another important goal of the behavior therapy is the therapy should be clear, concrete, understood, and acceptable or agreed upon by both the client and the counselor. This kind of a process requires a negotiation between the client and the counselor, which results in a contract that guides how the therapy should proceed. We can say behavioral strategies can be used not only to achieve the individual goals of the client, but also to achieve the societal goals. For example, most of the behavioral techniques are used in schools and hospitals and other institutes where there are rehabilitation centers in order to bring the patients or clients into the mainstream. These goals are endorsed by the society. Ultimately, we can say the goals set up by the counselor and the client in the behavioral process or behavioral therapy increases not only the personal choice but also leads to an effective living. Now, let us see what sort of a role the therapist should play if he is adapting a behavior therapy process. Generally, behaviorally oriented practitioners take clues given by the clients and also follow their own clinical hunches. They also use some common techniques like empathy, summarizing, reflection, acceptance, and open-ended questioning. However, they are different from the other psychotherapy practitioners. In what way? The reason is, or we can say, they are different in the following methods. Behavior therapists systematically make effort to identify the situational antecedents, dimensions of the problem behavior, and the consequences of the problem. Second thing is, they also try to clarify the client's problem. That is, the client is involved in remaking the statement problem. Then they design the target behavior, which has to be molded, which has to be changed. Once it is identified, they try to focus on formulating the goals for therapy, and these goals are set once again in consultation with the client. Once the goals are set, they try to identify the maintaining situations which may facilitate reaching a goal by the client. Then comes the implementing a change plan. What is the plan of action? What are the alternatives that are made in the strategy to reach the goal? Next step is evaluating the success of the change plan. And the last feature is to conduct the follow-up assignments. This behavior therapy is distinguished from the other therapies as elaborated procedures are followed by the behavior therapists. Another important function of the behavior therapist is role modeling. Bandura believes, like, we not only learn from our own experiences, but we also learn a lot by observing others through observational learning. So here, that is possible through imitation. Once we have observed, we try to imitate. Naturally, in this view, the therapist acts as a role model to the client. The client considers the counselor as a worthy person and tries to imitate or tries to learn or pattern attitudes, values, beliefs, and behavior of the counselor. So, the therapist should be aware that their role is very crucial and they have to present themselves as a good role model. Once we have understood what is the counselor's role, let us see what is the role of the client in the behavior therapy process. Behavior therapy provides the client with a precise role and a clear role. It stresses the importance of client's participation and also awareness in the therapeutic process. We can say both the counselor and the client play an active role in the behavior therapy. The client also engages in modeling, role playing, rehearsal, and also other active behaviors as part of the therapy and generally receive active homework assignments like monitoring his own behaviors under particular situations which take place at home or any other environment outside the therapeutic session. Clients must be motivated to change and must also be willing to cooperate in carrying out therapeutic activities, both during therapy sessions and also in everyday life situations. If clients are not taking an active part, the chances that the therapy is successful would be very slim. Clients are also encouraged in the behavior therapy to experiment upon new behaviors that would facilitate him to change his attitude or behavior or his feelings. Once they have learned a new behavior, they were encouraged to generalize that behavior in the appropriate situations so that they would be successful in handling the situations even outside the therapeutic sessions. We can say from this role of the client in the behavior therapy that he has to do a lot rather than just focusing on his own insights. He should be willing to make changes and also be willing to implement the changes that he felt are necessary. Only then the treatment will come to an end. Most of the time, the treatment goals in behavior therapy are stated in concrete and measurable terms, and this provides a frame of reference for the client whether he is approaching his own goals or whether he is drifting away from the goals. Once the client is aware that he is in the process and he is able to reach the goals, he would also be aware that when the treatment would come to a termination. Once we have seen the function of the therapist and also the role of the client, let us see what sort of a relationship that exists between the therapist, that is behavior therapist, and the client. It is quite understandable that any therapy would be successful only when there is a cordial relationship between the therapist and the client. And this would be possible only when the client develops the trust towards the counselor. Not only the trust, not only the cooperation on behalf of the client towards the counselor and the therapeutic processes, but the client should also have a positive attitude towards the treatment that he is undertaking and also should have a hope for success, which will facilitate a better result or a better outcome from the therapeutic process. Naturally, the skilled behavioral therapist focuses on this issue and tries to see that there is a cordial relationship that exists between the counselor and the client that would help them to facilitate change in the client's behavior. In fact, most of the counselors, that is the behavior therapists, feel mere providing of empathy or acceptance will not be sufficient, though they are necessary. But an array of skills are needed by the therapist in order to identify and bring about the clarity into the client's problem and thereby facilitating change in the behavior of the client. We can say that behaviorists function in a more active and directive role and also act as consultants and problem solvers. Most often they try to teach the client a coping model behavior, a coping model strategy, whereby the clients experiment upon learning new skills in dealing with the life stresses or with their emotions that are getting affected. So, all this happens in the client's natural environment where the support of the counselor is equally needed. Once we have seen the therapeutic structure, let us see what strategies are used by the behavior therapist. In fact, each therapy has its own strategies. Each therapy techniques are used and also significant in their own way. But behavioral therapeutic techniques have become very popular because immediately we can see the impact of those strategies on the client's behavior or the way the client is perceiving the situations and how he is able to react to the situations. So, we can say there are a bag of techniques which are adapted by the behavior therapists. But as we have already discussed, we don't pick randomly one technique from this bag of techniques for any particular client. Once we have identified what the problem is, how it occurred, what the goal is, naturally, in order to fit into the client's needs, we have to choose appropriate behavioral techniques. So, I can say a range of behavioral techniques or an array of behavioral techniques are available, and to name a few, relaxation training, systematic desensitization, exposure therapies, assertion training, self-management programs and multimodal therapy. Let us see about some of these techniques very briefly. Relaxation training. I think all of you are aware of this relaxation training. It is very popular and widely used technique in most of the situations, whether it is in a hospital setup or an academic setup or in a normal day-to-day life situations, because it is easy to learn and immediately it provides the relief when a person is confronted, when a person is affected with daily life stresses or anxiety. The main aim of relaxation training is it tries to achieve muscle and mental relaxation, and it is very easily learned. But maximum benefits can occur out of this particular technique if we are using this technique every day for a brief time or for a maximum amount of time. There are many relaxation procedures, but Jacobson's progressive muscle relaxation technique has become very popular. And generally, this kind of a relaxation technique is used in collaboration with other behavioral therapies. Relaxation training itself will not be relieving the problems of the client, but when we use along with the other behavioral therapy techniques, it would be much widely facilitating the change. So, apart from these relaxation training, or when we say like it is used along with the other behavioral techniques, mostly it is accompanied with the systematic desensitization. So, let us see what this systematic desensitization is. Systematic desensitization is another popular technique developed by Joseph Wolf, one of the pioneers of behavior therapy. In this particular technique, clients are asked to imagine successively anxiety evoking stimuli or situations. At the same time, they engage in a behavior that competes with the anxiety. Gradually or systematically, the clients become less sensitive or say desensitized to this anxiety arousing situation. This procedure can be considered as a form of exposure therapy, as clients are required to expose themselves to anxiety evoking stimulus or images as a way of reducing anxiety. This is based on systematic desensitization is based on the principle of classical conditioning, and this is most widely researched technique in most using the empirical procedures. It was initially used in treating anxiety related disorders, but now it is not only used to treat anxiety but also avoidance reactions. It is proved to be an efficient and effective treatment method. Next is the exposure therapy. Desensitization is one form of exposure therapy. Apart from that, we have other exposure therapies like in vivo desensitization and flooding. If you look at carefully at these techniques, systematic desensitization, in vivo desensitization and flooding, all of them look similar at the outset, but there is a slight variation. In systematic desensitization, the client is not exposed to the actual fearful situations. He is only asked to imagine the anxiety arousing situations. Whereas, when it comes to in vivo desensitization, it involves the exposure of the client to actual feared situations in the hierarchy in real life rather than simply imagining the situations. Clients engage in a brief and graduated series of exposures to these fearful events. Clients can terminate exposure if they experience a high level of anxiety. The underlying assumption behind this technique is, by being exposed to the fearful situation in the real life, automatically they try to be desensitized towards that fearful situation. Flooding. This is another form of exposure therapy, as we have already discussed. It refers to either in vivo or imaginal exposure to anxiety evoking stimuli for a prolonged period of time. In vivo flooding consists of intense and prolonged exposure to the actual anxiety provoking situations. Remaining exposed to the fearful stimulus for a prolonged period without engaging in anxiety reducing mechanisms allows the anxiety to reduce on its own. This is the main premise behind this technique. Another important technique is assertion training. This is one form of social skills training. This can be useful for those who cannot express anger or irritation, who have difficulty saying no, who are overly polite and allowing others to take advantage of it, who find difficult to express affection and other positive responses, or who feel they do not have a right to express their thoughts, beliefs, and emotions. Many assertion training methods are based upon the principles of cognitive behavioral therapies. Most of the assertion training programs focus on identifying clients' negative self-statements, self-defeating beliefs, and also faulty thinking. The last but not the least technique that is used in behavioral therapies is self-management programs and self-directed behavior. Self-management strategies include self-monitoring, self-reward, self-contracting, and stimulus control. The basic idea of this particular technique is that change can be brought by teaching people to use coping skills in problematic situations. Generalization and maintenance of the outcomes are enhanced by encouraging the clients to accept the responsibility for carrying out these strategies in daily life. Self-management strategies have been applied to many populations and many problems, including anxiety, depression, and panic.